Well, I'd like to call this Monday, April 7th, 2014 regular meeting of the Eugene Planning Commission to order. And as is our custom, we have a few minutes at the beginning of each meeting for public comment. And if you'd like to make public comment and have not done so already, please grab one of these green forms on the counter and fill those out for us. The public may comment on any matter except for items scheduled for public hearing or public hearing items for which the record has already closed. Generally, we limit that time to 3 minutes, and we reserve the right to reduce the time based on the number of people requesting to speak. We have two that have requested so far this morning. But before we get to that, we have received a request from the Sustainability Commission to have three members of the Transportation Subcommittee sit at the table with us today. And that would be Howie Bonnet and Sasha Luftig and Sue Wolling. And I wanted to just kind of put that out to the Commission to see what your thoughts were on that. We're not deliberating on anything. We're not making any decisions today, but they have requested to join the discussion. So what's the Commission's flavor? I wanted to hit that before the public comment period so that if not, they had opportunity to have public comment. But any objections or
Commissioner Duncan? They're going to just be part of our group during discussions?
They would be part of our group during the discussion, yeah.
I don't have any problem with it.
Okay.
I support the idea.
Commissioner Belcher, okay. Commissioner Borowski?
I don't have any problems with
I'm seeing a whole bunch of thumbs-ups. Okay. All right. Well, what I'll do is maybe then open up the public comment period, and then before we move into the presentation, I'll invite them to the table with us. So I have two names before us. David, I can't read your writing. Is it Necken? Nelken, okay. And if you could, Commissioner Jaworski is always worried about mispronouncing names, so my apologies.
That's all right.
And please state your name and address. And
is this thing on?
Yes.
It is.
My name is David Nelken, and I am a 34-year business owner and recent property owner at 2472 Willamette Street. I own Eugene Coin and Jewelry on the street. I'm here today to advocate for the four-lane option on Willamette Street. As many of you know, the Firefighter Union has emphatically stated, with important fire science behind them, that they favor the four-lane option on the street. I think it's important that we give our first responders the tools and the latitude to do their job. Safety is of utmost importance, and I think it's probably the prime factor should be the prime factor in any decision that eventually will be made. In speaking about safety, I'd like to also advocate for shared bikeways on Portland and Oak Street with connections to Amazon Parkway. To me, that seems to be the safest alternative for access for bikes into the neighborhood. It reduces the amount of car and bike interaction on the street and gives the bikers the safest route and the easiest route to achieve access to the street. Another factor I think in all of our decisions should be the look at the future of the street, not just the present. And that is, Civic Stadium is unused now and it will be repurposed in the future, whether it be a soccer stadium or a retail setting, who knows. But in doing so, traffic will increase. Also, we have the Envision Eugene process that you folks are all involved with, and in that process, the city has said that they would like to add between 1,000 and 3,000 people to this neighborhood between Portland and Oak Street. Well, all those cars are going to need four lanes to travel up and down the street, and I would advocate for keeping the street in that present configuration. I really feel that even though the economic study that you'll hear today is, I believe, will be a big neutral, I can tell you from a perspective of a 34-year business owner that if you reduce the amount of cars that go down the street, which the DKS study has said that there's going to be a minimum of 500, and I believe it'll be worse than that when we find that there could be backups, I think you reduce the potential for business on the street. top-of-mind awareness in any business is important, and the least expensive and best advertising for a business is those who drop by, who drive by, of course, and see your business. So any reduction of that through through the reduction in 50% of the travel through lanes on the street, in my mind, is detrimental to business. That's all I have to say, and I appreciate your folks' time.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Nelkin. Next, we have Alan Hancock.
Alan Hancock, 2244 Alder Street. I'm a member of the Bicycle and Pedestrian Advisory Committee, of which there are 14 members on the committee, and we drafted a letter to the City Council that they will be receiving next week in advance of a public hearing in May. And I wanted to make sure that you all got a chance to hear the letter, since I don't think that it's been delivered to you. And you will. This is addressed to Mr. Henry here to convey to the mayor and City Council that the Bicycle and Pedestrian Advisory Committee opposes a trial restriping of South Willamette Street. A trial would provide useful information to the council only if the trial could fully emulate the conditions of Alternative 3. A trial conducted without implementing all the measures in Alternative 3 would not accurately portray the conditions and use of the road once all the improvements are completed, and would thus provide misleading data. With hundreds of road configurations similar to Alternative 3 already in successful use around the country, and I should say around the world, a trial would unnecessarily increase the cost of the project to the city, to businesses, and to users of the street. Currently, there are numerous impediments to safe and comfortable travel by foot or bicycle on South Willamette Street, which I'm sure you know. The mandate of the South Willamette Improvement Plan, that's a mandate of the South Improvement Plan, is to address these problems and to transform the street into, quote, a vibrant urban corridor accessible by bicycle, foot, car, and bus. In addition to new lane markings, the plan calls for correcting drainage issues that result in water pooling on the side of the street, increasing the width of sidewalks, reducing the speed of traffic, upgrading the quality of road surface, and eliminating hazardous driveway lips that can cause bicyclists to take a fall. Alternative 3 also recommends an additional intersection at Woodfield Station and the timing of lights to assist traffic flow with fewer lanes. Staff has included many of these recommended elements in the proposed trial, and we may be hearing about that soon. However, if a trial doesn't feature all the changes associated with Alternative 3, then that trial will provide inaccurate results, as some potential users will continue to avoid the street because of poor pavement, poor water quality, pooled water, or so forth. A meaningful trial must create a design that is substantially the same as Alternative 3, or it will not convince anyone of anything. Even if a trial were implemented with all of these features prescribed in Alternative 3, it's unlikely that this significant private investment on South Willamette would occur until after the design is certain and the street construction is complete. And developers will wait until redevelop businesses, construct housing, or relocate offices until after all the dust has settled. And they're only going to do that. The economic revitalization will only occur on South Willamette Street. We won't be seen with a trial. So, fortunately, there's ample evidence from cities around the nation that designing human-scale streets can trigger the renaissance of aging streets such as Willamette. Finally, road construction, while necessary to ensure the long-term infrastructure, can have a negative impact on businesses. Bicycles, pedestrians, and motorists alike will be impacted. A trial would result in disruption to businesses and users of South Willamette Street, not once, but twice, with an extra cost of hundreds of thousands of dollars. So the recommended redesign of South Willamette Street is not only about adding bike lanes, but also about creating a vibrant place that's accessible to everyone, including motorists, but pedestrians and transit users. We applaud the fact that the professional traffic engineers hired by the city, the DPS, recommended Alternative 3. This alternative employs a wide range of enhancements that have created safe, comfortable, and prosperous streets in communities around the country. So we know that the Planning Commission isn't in charge of making the decision, but we're encouraging the City Council to choose Alternative 3, and would be happy to see an expedited timeline so that completion of this project would bring the benefits of to our community ahead of the scheduled 2018 completion. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Hancock. Just a moment.
Can I make a request? Just because obviously we can't write notes as fast as you could. Could you submit the copy of this to the staff that they can distribute this to the...
Yes, I will do that.
So we can look at it our... You know.
I will do that.
And I would suggest also, if you have any written comments, maybe... That you, that you, you know, your testimony was...
I'd be glad to give you a submission.
Yeah, just submit it to staff and they'll forward it to us.
Thank you.
Is that reasonable?
Yes, okay. That is. Okay. Now, anyone else that didn't get a chance to fill out a green slip? Okay. If I could invite now the three members of the Sustainability Commission to join us at the table. And I'm trying to think, actually, Chris, how many people do you... You need two chairs? Okay. So we've got some room here. And... just want to encourage and remind everyone to, as you speak, we'll have Chris and his team's presentation first, and then we'll open it up for discussion. But as you speak, if you don't actually have a microphone right in front of you, and even if you do, for the purposes of the public record, please speak into the microphone, speak clearly, all those good things, and. The way I generally run the discussion, I'll go over after Chris makes his presentation. So let's get started.
Thank you, Chair and Planning Commission. My name is Chris Henry. I'm the City of Eugene Transportation Planning Engineer, and we're here to speak with you today about the South Willamette Street Improvement Plan, provide you with a process update, results of an economic study. With me is Ed Whitelaw of Echo Northwest, who will present the results of that study, and we can entertain questions that you might have, and I can also provide you information about a test restriping of the street that the City Council has requested, and we've developed detailed information about the scope of such a test that we can discuss as well. Process-wise, we're meeting today with you, and then in a couple of weeks on April 16th with the Eugene City Council. They'll have a work session to receive the full draft South Willamette Street Improvement Plan, of which you've already seen. You've seen the South Willamette Street Improvement Plan, but you have not seen the economic study. The council will see both the plan and the economic study, as well as the scope of a test restriping on April 16th. There's also been a public hearing scheduled for May 19th. That's May 19th for the Eugene City Council to hold a public hearing about the South Willamette Street Improvement Plan alternatives. We're working on a date for their deliberation and action, probably a week or so following the public hearing. I'll know more about that this afternoon. So the main purpose for today is to allow Eco Northwest to share the results of their work. I think we understand what the purpose of the plan is here, and it was stated by one of the speakers that the study is to help Willamette Street become a vibrant urban corridor accessible by bicycle, foot, car, and bus. Part of that vibrancy is the success of the businesses, and Eco Northwest has looked to examine how the street, any changes to the street might affect that. Ed?
Sure. I should say I'm also at the University of Oregon. Just give them equal weight. But this study that my colleagues and I performed for the city was through Echo Northwest. And so about a year ago, December last year, city asked us to examine, by relying on the professional literature, the effects that the road diet, the proposed reconfiguration might have on businesses, and so we did. And so I assume you guys are conversant in road diets, at least the term. Okay, so the literature, the broad literature on road diets is in fact very broad. It's very extensive. The portion of that literature that deals with the effects on businesses is substantially more narrow. We examined something like 50 studies, and of those, maybe 20 purported to, or in some cases actually did, address the effects on businesses, where those effects ranged from measures or proxies for revenues, for property values, for visits by customers, those kinds of things. And the changes in the configuration of a road, when you're talking about economic effects, the measures that have been used, and I'll just read them off quickly, vehicular traffic volumes in the corridor, and the assumption is the greater the volume, the greater the sales, and the greater the revenues. Similarly, non-vehicular trips serving the same purpose, total number of trips with destinations within the corridor, and then business access, where that is on both the demand side and the supply side. Supply side would be deliveries. Demand side, of course, would be sales. The findings. Most studies, as the contrast between the 50 we examined and the only 20 that were addressing business effects in one way or another, most studies focus on motor vehicle volumes, traffic times, congestion, accidents, that kind of thing. On urban arterials with less than 20,000 average daily trips, the effects of road diets have been modest. So if you just back up a moment and pretend you're statisticians, larger samples usually yield more robust findings than small samples. And so what we are at, Chris, I think in the range of 16,000?
Yes.
Average trips daily. So you start to get fuzzy results, wider ranges in which you have confidence, that kind of thing. On those fewer studies addressing the effects on business, the effects were also modest, to even the point of being inconclusive. And those studies that rose to the level of attention getting were almost entirely on major urban centers. We're talking New York, San Francisco, LA, making them inapplicable to South Willamette. If you want one word to summarize our findings, they are inconclusive, or it is inconclusive. Those are my remarks.
Thank you. At this point, Chris, do you have more presentation? Are we wanting to open it up for discussion, or?
We could go a couple different directions as you wish. We could talk about the economic study now with the questions, and then move into discussion about test restriping, or I can talk about the test restriping now, and then we can open it up later.
Why don't we maybe go ahead and open it up now for discussion based on this, and then come back to the restriping discussion. So just for the sustainability commissioners, the way I usually do it is, if you want to speak, raise your hand. I do my best to write people's names down in the queue in order, and I generally will try and give everyone at the table a chance to speak before I go back and repeat someone. So I saw a couple of hands over here, I think, Commissioner Belcher. And okay.
Dr. Whitelaw, I'll freely admit I've taken one economics class and I got a C in college. So forgive my question, but it's...
I don't think any less of you.
And it was a few years ago, too. I heard what you said, and I'm just wondering if there isn't an alternative conclusion, which is there's no effect or minimal effect.
Okay, in a strict sense, and I'm sort of copying out a little bit by resorting to statistics, but if the results are insignificant, then among the conclusions, plausible conclusions, would be the effects are very small or the effects don't exist. So if I just sort of back up and say, okay, I'll give the professionally prudent response, yes, that's a possible conclusion. That said, the best of the studies found some evidence of effects. That was York Boulevard. I'm looking at Michael Weinerman, one of the colleagues who plowed through all 50. And it was well designed in the sense that there was a single corridor that was in effect split in half. And on one portion, the road diet was introduced, and on the other, it was not. So there were contrasts that could be gleaned from the data. So if you've got 20 studies, and most of them have limitations of one kind or another, and you find one that meets professional standards, then while I can say from what we saw and imputing those results or those findings to South Willamette, it's inconclusive, is not to say that from these various studies there one can conclude there might be some effects. And those were on the positive side on business rather than the negative side. But again, it's one study. It's in a very large metropolitan area. This is LA. So there.
Okay. Thank you.
And again, my so there is mostly just
not negating what I said.
Right.
Okay. Thank you. Commissioner Baker.
Yeah, I was going to ask about the, I can understand why you might prefer to exclude the major urban areas, but a lot of urban areas are really conglomerations of smaller areas that are glued together, and you know, sometimes traffic tends to be localized to an area to a certain extent. Is there some well-known reason to, I mean, in other words, if you found some areas that were in New York or LA that, or other major urban areas that had areas that had traffic less than 20,000 and, you know, met some other criteria you may have selected to be comparable, is there some other reason that you would exclude those?
No. Michael, do you remember the volumes on New York?
I don't remember the volumes for many of these studies, but one of the major differences is that your composition of mode of travel differs quite a bit. So in New York, there were some studies in New York, but in those settings, you have so many pedestrians that the impacts of a road diet would be different in kind.
Okay, but that wouldn't necessarily be the case in, say, L.A.,
not necessarily. My understanding from the York Boulevard study was that in that setting it was fundamentally different than South Willamette.
Okay.
Not from LA, so I didn't see it on the ground.
And Mr. Baker, you may recall that one of the reasons, so I teach urban economics, as you know, as you've suffered, in Eugene, it's hard to get illustrations of a number of urban economic principles. So among urban economists, there's this jargon of we look to the large cities to get a Bunsen burner clarity of the kinds of principles we see evidence of, but vaguely in a city as small as Eugene. So there's some of that going on as well that my case addresses.
One follow-up question, just to,
okay.
It seems pretty obvious that it's difficult to get funding for economic studies on these smaller areas. Is that part of the problem? You wouldn't just see them readily available, and
right. There's a more cynical view as well, namely, a study in a journal addressing Eugene is probably in an obscure journal. If you've got New York or LA or San Francisco, it gets more attention. In part, though, for the legitimate reason that you can enjoy a Bunsen burner effect in a much larger city, and you get many more observations than you otherwise might get.
Commissioner Jaworski.
It's always a pleasure to follow Commissioner Baker. I agree with sometimes, even though it's a large urban area, you do have compositions of neighborhoods within that. I don't believe personally that when you look at almost any street that you're always going to find it's not comparable to the street you're looking at. There's going to be variables that don't match, which always say, well, then it isn't conclusive. From looking at this, and I'm referring just to the PC agendas on page 7, 10, 11, and 12, I rather thought there was significant information here to point positively to no effect on the businesses. That included not only New York and Los Angeles, as mentioned, but Vancouver and Seattle, probably more closer to us, Ashland, where three-quarters of the businessmen said it had no effect, and one-quarter, I think, if I remember correctly, said it only affected, let's say, deliveries or something like that to them. So I kind of feel that if one would say there's no conclusive results they can draw from this study, I think there's a lot that's saying that it didn't appear to have an effect on the businesses that maybe was envisioned when it was first discussed. I'd also like to point out, which is somewhat significant, that in road diets, page 7 again and elsewhere in the study, it does point out that they had a significant reduction in accidents, crash injuries, etc., which is something we should look at when we're looking at safety for any reconfiguration. My question, those were my comments. My question is on page 4 of our PC agenda. There's an indication that 37% of the people traveling on this route, which is 16,500 ADT, are through travelers. If they do take alternate routes, you know, your traffic then is going to go down to maybe 11,000 ADT, which is a significant reduction if they use these alternate routes. But I guess my question in coming up with what the through traffic is that was there an origin and destination study done to determine that, or how was that arrived at?
So the information you're referring to is this pie chart that's in the executive summary and the draft plan that talks about the nature of trips in the corridor, whether or not they have a destination or stopping in the corridor or passing through, either on Willamette Street or 29th Avenue. We used Bluetooth antennas to pick up signals from either GPSs or telephones, cell phones, as people move through the corridor to establish that origin and destination as for where they entered the corridor and where they exited and at what time that happened. So each of these mobile devices has a unique identifier. It's sort of like reading a license plate that is the other method that you can use that's much more labor intensive. So yes, there was an origin and destination study probing the Bluetooth devices in the corridor.
Wow, I love sci-fi, and this sounds good. What would be the reliability of utilizing that source of information through mobile devices versus an actual on-the-ground physical questionnaire as far as reliability of each, as far as statistically accurate?
Well, actually interviewing everybody that uses the street will be much more accurate, mm-hmm. and much more labor-intensive. So probe methods are much easier and less expensive to implement, and that's what we and other jurisdictions do. It's
Did these signals give you any indication of where they traversed after, where they went after they went through the corridor to see whether or not which of the two alternate streets might be impacted differently?
No, we had a limited number of antennas
okay.
In the corridor.
Thank you.
Okay. Commissioner Duncan.
I'm okay right now. Thank you.
Okay. Commissioner Lefting.
I just had a quick question about the scope of the study. Did it look at not just road diets, but the impact of adding bicycle infrastructure onto streets and the impact, whether positive or negative, on businesses?
And by bicycle infrastructure?
Whether it be a bicycle lane or a cycle track.
As I recall, it varied.
Michael?
We didn't explicitly focus on bicycle infrastructure. We mostly looked at the reduction in automobile trips and how that would affect businesses. So my understanding from the traffic study is that it's very hard to tell how bicycle trips would be affected and how that would affect total trips on South Willamette. So that's how it would have played into our study.
And before I go back to Commissioner Baker, are there others, Commissioner?
I guess, and I probably, it's there someplace, but I don't know. What is the projected loss of ADTs on the corridor if it were to go to scenario three?
Well, it depends for a couple of reasons. Mm. The analysis was based on traffic volumes gathered in 2010. Those volumes were in the mid-16,000 vehicles per day. This last May, we measured the traffic volumes, and then again a couple months ago in February, we measured the traffic volumes. In February, the volumes were in the low 14,000 vehicles per day. So rather than projecting an increase, what we've actually seen is a drop of nearly 2,000 vehicles a day in 4 years. So that makes... My response, it depends. I'm not exactly sure what the volumes will be in 2018. Will they be flat? Will they go up? Will they go down? Based on recent information, they might indeed go down and be lower than what we projected. So our analysis is likely quite conservative, meaning that it would overestimate levels of congestion and traffic volume on the street.
Okay, excuse me. What years were the two traffic studies?
The traffic volume counts were from 2010 and then recently February of 2014.
Thank you.
And so getting back to that, in my reading of the economic impacts, that was one of the areas that there was significant literature on it. You know, if ADTs go down, that there was statistical stuff that you found that you could correlate. Is that right?
Not on business.
Oh.
Well, excuse me. Are we talking about just the 20 studies that were addressing business effects?
Yeah, it seemed to me that ADT was mentioned in here as far as if it goes down, you know, lease prices sometimes might go down or you know, people that like the one of the persons who testified earlier, you know, you drive by is a marketing type of thing that businesses use.
Yes. back to ADTs. The businesses might see the effect immediately if there is an effect. The effect on property values will be lagged in some way. And it depends, you know, that depends on any number of conditions peculiar to the sites along the arterial.
Thank you. A little follow-up on that. I mentioned that the traffic volumes dropped 2,000 vehicles per day in the last 4 years. However, during the peak hour where we did the analysis for delay calculations, they only decreased around 50 vehicles per hour. So they're overall, the volumes are down, but during the peak, they seem to remain similar.
Okay. And then was there any – did you also do traffic counts on the workarounds on Hilliard and Amazon Parkway? And the only reason I ask that is, you know, I have a business on Pearl Street, and I've noticed Pearl Street at peak times, you know, backing up quite a bit at 18th because everybody's using the parkway, or not everybody, but I've noticed in the last couple of years that, you know, it's about three light cycles to get through 18th and Pearl now at peak time.
We did not measure parallel streets most recently. We did in 2013.
Okay.
And I'm going to insert myself into the queue. I had a question, kind of a follow-up to the February, I think, counts that you were mentioning. Could
were any of those counts related to weather at all? I guess I'm wondering, I know we've had some inclement weather that people tend to stay home, and I didn't know if there was, and I think it might have been in February, and I just wanted to make sure that we weren't getting maybe false readings based on weather as far as decreases. I know that made us stay home.
The counts were on a Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, February 24th, 25th, 26th. The Monday volumes were a bit lower, but the 25th and 26th volumes, or the volumes that we used, were within 50 vehicles of each other on those two consecutive days.
I don't remember what the weather was like those particular days. It was early February. Early February was the bad weather?
Yeah,
it was, okay.
No, I just... Oh, okay. When the snow was. Okay.
Yes. When the snow, yeah. I just wanted to make sure that we were...
You weren't counting
under,
when the snow...
We weren't counting, during the snow.
No, we waited until that cleared.
Okay.
Yes.
All right. Well, we'll start back through then. I have Commissioner Baker and Commissioner Jaworski.
Yeah, just a comment first about the... Just because I'm the technical in this area. The advantage of those antenna studies is... They only work if you happen to have a phone, a Bluetooth, a smartphone on, right, that has Bluetooth, and the signal is strong enough to reach your antenna, which may always not be Bluetooth. And the other signal was the phone signal itself, right?
These are GPS Bluetooth antennas that
just they
many,
were just they were just
any
Bluetooth.
Devices have Bluetooth. If you have a hands-free headset, if you have a a GPS device, they're often communicating as well.
Right, but I'm saying, so you are only measuring Bluetooth, not mobile signals themselves?
Correct. Okay. And there is limited penetration in the market for that. It's a surrogate for other survey methods.
Right. So the limitation that is a lot of Bluetooth devices have a fairly weak transmitter. Depending on where these antennas were, they may not have picked up all of them, but they would have picked up somebody walking around with a phone, too. Going through the
antennas are quite sensitive.
Yeah, so surprised. So you would have picked up people walking through the corridor and could have shown sort of a certain amount of those people that didn't exit the corridor to later. But the one thing I wanted to comment on is obviously older people, there's a lower penetration of smartphones. Say, I mean, they might have mobile phones. I mean, there's certainly and less use by older people of some of these technologies. So. You're going to tend to, in general, you're going to tend to be tracking more people that are in middle age or young or student types that would have these kind of devices. So that would be one limitation, in terms of the results versus saying, photographing license plates, which would have been, more expensive but more accurate in terms of traffic. The other thing I was going to ask about is, and I'm kind of combining it with a comment. There are some other changes that have been going on. I mean, you can look at the statistics from the university about the number of people that are now has increased the number of people using mass transit or bicycling to the university. And because this is one of the areas that's a shopping area that could be used by people that live in the university, did you look at the potential impact or the number of, some of these businesses might have a certain number of customers that arrive by bicycle now. That would be the restaurants and the food, all of the different places. Did you look at all in any of your studies about the transportation using bicycle or pedestrian to getting to businesses and how common that was in these arterial corridors?
So. Let me take a shot at that. We didn't, and then Michael can clean it up. We did not take any of the studies and try to adjust them by parameters or information from the university relationships here. The corridor studies, as I understand it, that were parts of these of these various things took the evidence from the street as given, as opposed to disaggregating the nature of the sales by sector, by occupation, by that kind of thing. Have I got that?
Okay.
Did that answer?
Yeah, I'm just.
You're mulling.
Well, I'm just thinking out loud. I mean, obviously, I mean, I live 15th and Mill, okay?
Right.
And although students have cars that they may use for longer trips, which include shopping and inclement weather, say, there is a lot of period of times where, you know, the big push is to get bicycles nowadays, so they all have bicycles where they didn't three or four or 5 years ago, and you see them bicycling all over the place,
right.
So without helmets very often, but, you know. You know, because it's such a close proximity to the student-occupied area, which is Amazon and West University and South, and there's just...
There are studies about shopping from patrons dependent on the mode that they're traveling, either walking, biking, or driving a car. This research did not discern or discriminate between those studies at that level. I believe it's primarily focused on automobile travel. And as an earlier question came, there are economic benefits to and evidence for the economic benefits of walking and biking infrastructure. But the focus of the study was most primarily about the relationship to the automobile.
Okay. And I have three in the queue, and I want to make sure we save enough time for the restriping. About how much time will you think you need for that?
Questions, but
okay.
I could try to get through it in 5 minutes, and then we
so
can talk
about a 5-minute presentation. Okay, I just want to make sure that we save enough time to give that adequate attention. So I have Commissioners Jaworski, then Belcher, then I think Wolling.
When I think of an economic study, I guess I'm thinking of broad impacts, but also impacts on businesses. And I believe to follow up, I believe it's Sasha had said something about bicycle infrastructure. Two places in the report, PC Agenda page 10, talks about studies have found that bike lanes, pedestrians, all these sort of things have a very positive impact on sales tax revenue, noting we don't have sales tax revenue, but to have an increase in sales tax revenue must mean you're selling more. So you're selling more. Additionally, on page 12 of the PC Agenda, it talks about the fact that studies have shown, and many of them, I believe, that pedestrians and bikers will actually buy more than motorists, except in large-scale areas. So I have two questions. The first question was, with this information that you gathered, did you take a look at the projected either pedestrian or bicycle usage along this with the reconfiguration? And secondly, did you do an analysis of the corridor to see the types of businesses and how they relate to those types of shopping? Granted, a large furniture store, you know, we're not going to bike or carry that when walking, but I mean, other than a grocery store, you know, how would this mix fit for the economic impact along the corridor?
Eco Northwest's study was primarily a literature review, not specific to the environment on Willamette Street or the mixture of businesses on Willamette Street or the number of people walking or biking versus driving a car on Willamette Street.
So why then? Who's doing the literature review findings and now doing that economic impact? I thought that's what this was, the economic impact.
So our approach was working collaboratively with business and property owner representatives to define the scope of the study. The first phase was to examine the information that's available. And they did that. We regrouped, reviewed the information, which is in their report. And then we asked the question, could we find more information if we dug a little deeper and spent more money and effort to do that? And the conclusion was that we wouldn't find substantially more information to change the inconclusiveness of the work, and decided not to spend extra time and effort and money on that work.
Okay, I guess I didn't have a chance, or I was negligent in not reviewing whatever that meeting's reports were, but did those businesses ask a similar question of how would that affect my revenues? If I have a concern as a business, I would say, well, you know, how much more bikers or walkers am I going to get, and what would that mean to me? They didn't ask that.
There was certainly concern about, I'm not sure if this is the right word, but parity between, like, if somebody stops driving in their car and starts walking or biking, would there be equal revenue generated, or what the effect might be? That wasn't a specific question that was asked. The focus, again, was primarily automobile-oriented shopping and what the street reconfiguration might do. More broadly, the research does include those other effects of people walking and biking if they're looking at the total revenue, and it's not mode or how people arrived specific and how they spent their funds. There is research about that. Typically, it says that people arriving by bicycle or foot spend less per purchase but more per time period, like week or month, on their purchases, primarily in businesses selling food and beverage.
Okay. Commissioner Belcher.
In the interest of time, I'll withdraw my time. Thank you.
Okay. Commissioner Woolley.
Well, I'm guessing that there really isn't an answer to this question, but I was just wondering if there's any way of connecting, you know, the time of day and the days that businesses do the most business related to the time of traffic. In other words, if most businesses sell the most on Saturdays, you know, then the average peak congestion time, you know, means a little something different than if, you know, it's really during the rush hour that they do make most of their sales. Is there any indication of, you know, is most business done during the times of most congestion, or is that just people trying to go pick up the kids, get to soccer practice, you know, go home, eat dinner, yeah, that sort of thing?
I can't really speak to what time of day people shop, but there is correlation between total traffic volume and lease rates for properties that has, right or wrong, some indication that they're making a connection between how many motor vehicles pass by a business and the exposure to that business and the potential for sales. Maybe not real, but potential, certainly for sales. Traffic volumes do vary by time of day and day of week. The focus on the evening peak is not necessarily about economics, but it's about how the transportation system operates, and that is the standard measure is the PM, well, the most congested period, which typically is the PM peak, and we use a midweek day typically for that.
Commissioner Bonnet.
Thank you. This is Mr. Bonnet. Thank you for allowing us to join you at the table. I just have one question after having read the report and listened to the presentation. As a scientist, I think I share everyone's frustration at the lack of comparable issues out there, situations where we could all look at and say, well, this is really directly relevant and what we wanted to know as a result of the study. But I'm wondering whether if another study is done in which average daily travel, time of travel, accident rates, and so forth are done on the Willamette Corridor, I'm wondering whether that study would actually materially improve the frustration that exists around the question of whether the road diet in this case would have a positive or an adverse impact on the businesses along Willamette.
If that was a question, I'm not
that,
sure.
That was a question.
That's something we'll talk about in the scope of a test and the value of a test. And economics is.
Could the author of the study have a?
Well, if there are no other questions, maybe we could move into the test, and that is an element that we can discuss about it.
Okay. I think we've got two. I've got Commissioner Baker and myself, so maybe we can
come back to
that. Yeah, I was actually going to ask in the study as far as Table 1 where you had streets similar to South Willamette with the reconfigurations, I noticed that Gleason Street in Portland seemed to be the most comparable. And was there anything that you were able to glean from that that might
be helpful in this comparison to South Willamette. And I know that that may not have had an economic study attached to it, but I'm just curious, as looking through that, where it was roughly the same ADT going four-lane to three-lane plus bike lanes, urban, mixed use, fairly recent. I didn't know if there anything rose to the surface that was indicative from that study or from that reconfiguration.
Not really. A corridor like Gleason might offer some kind of control for the test if it were conducted for South Willamette, as opposed to, here's this single observation, it didn't have the study broad enough to warrant including formally in any of the findings other than it's more noise than not in the kinds of findings we wanted for revenues and so on. Is that making sense? That is,
I think so.
It's more, Michael, am I blowing it? Okay. It's more anecdotal.
Mm-hmm.
And perhaps promising for a control later in the comparability or the like.
Okay. Thank you. Commissioner Baker.
Yeah. Two short questions. One of them is more about the literature. Is there anything in the literature that talks about the differences between through traffic and regular traffic in terms of the impacts, economic impacts on the business? And I could see where that would be complicated because through traffic might be through traffic most of the day, and then at the end of the workday at 5, people stop at, like, PC Market, and then it becomes different. But if there's any literature that discusses that at all.
There was in the 60s when I was in graduate school. Since then, there's been more. But you have to disaggregate those data to distinguish between the through drivers and the non-through drivers,
mm-hmm.
in order to truly separate those. Clearly, some of the through drivers never stop in the interval. Others, as you say, may batch their shopping trips at some opportune time during the week or on Saturdays or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
It takes some pretty heroic data to distinguish among those drivers.
My other half of the question was, you have this data that from your studies. Did you actually look at projections per hour? In other words, you might see that there's a certain amount of through traffic, in the middle of the day, but then a lot of that through traffic might end up being terminal stops at sort of, what would you call it, the large markets like PC Market on the way out of town. I think you had some comments there. You go into any shopping food store at 5 o'clock and it's a nightmare, so that's clearly there's something else going on there where people are, they might have been commuters, but now all of a sudden they're stopping at some keystone shopping area to do some shops. And the side effect of that is, does that have an impact on smaller businesses?
We analyzed the morning peak and the evening peak, but we weren't analyzing what the nature of people's trips were and where they were stopping or for what purpose.
No, but if you actually even projected what that through traffic was per hour, you would maybe get a different picture. That all of a sudden you would see, the percent of through traffic percent might have actually dropped at 9 and 5, and it might go up.
The probe data would likely be able to reveal that because it's continual.
Yeah,
through time.
Just suggesting that would be a simple thing to do to get some idea of, if there's an impact. I mean, if through traffic stays the same percentage, then there's obviously no impact. But I suspect you would find that there's going to be a difference.
Okay. Well, with that, maybe we can move into, Chris, your presentation on the test reconfiguration, and then we can revisit that.
So City Council, at their June 2013 work session, was curious about and asked staff to come back with information about test restriping of Willamette Street. So I prepared for them. It's due today at 5, so it's not information I provided to you, but information about the scope, schedule, and budget of a test. The scope, as concern has been raised, needs to be as comparable to the final street configuration as possible. Things that that a test would not do: it would not repave the street, it would not fix drainage problems, and it would not improve the sidewalks. But what it would do would be to restripe Willamette Street from 24th Avenue all the way through 29th and connect the bikeway systems north of 24th Avenue and south of 29th. There would necessarily, to be able to do that, be some widening of the curbs north of 24th Avenue to allow for a center turn lane for southbound traffic, and to connect the bikeway system from Willamette Street to 24th Avenue, because it stops short of there now. There would also be the construction of a permanent traffic signal at the Woodfield Station driveway on Willamette Street, and necessary right-of-way acquisition and moving of curbs to allow for a turn lane there. Those improvements at the Woodfield Station driveway and at 24th Avenue would benefit any of the street design alternatives, including four lanes. And so those, while they would, so scope, schedule, and budget, I'll have to jump around a little bit, but those, there's an incremental cost to making the test, and I'll come back to that later. And our intent, as I was saying, is to be as apples-to-apples comparison to the street design alternative. So it would, other than the pavement surface, provide the same lane striping, presumably as alternative three lanes with bike lanes. The purpose is not necessarily to test how bike lanes function on Willamette Street, because you have the rough surface. We do have some budget money to smooth the driveway lips that was a concern raised, but the sidewalks, again, are not improved. And so we would not necessarily expect to see more people walking or biking in the corridor. The primary purpose of the test is to measure the effect on people driving cars, and that seems to be where most of the concern in the community is. I may say anecdotally from my observations that people are wondering, how could this work? We've done our analysis. We believe the analysis is sound, but a test could confirm that analysis and measure both economic effects that we can talk about in a little more detail, effects on the transportation system where people are concerned about increased delay or diversion of trips to other streets, and public opinion are some opportunities to monitor. So in addition to the restriping and the construction activity, there could be follow-up or concurrent monitoring of the street from an economic perspective, a transportation perspective, and a public opinion perspective. The schedule would necessarily be 2 years from now before we could report back with information on a test. We need first a decision of whether or not to go forward with a test, and then time to contract with consultants, depending on the range of monitoring that we would perform during a test. If there's an economic study included, there would be time needed to gather before data or before test economic data from businesses on the street, then a period for construction to occur, and then a three-month period for people to adjust to the change before we actually monitor the performance of the street for a full year. So one scenario could be a decision this spring or summer about whether or not to go forward with the test, hiring consultants, potentially Eco Northwest and DKS Associates again for economics and transportation, gather before data before the fall, and in the fall, say October or so, restripe the street and allow people to normalize their behavior through the winter months, and then January to January, we could have the full test. We'd need a few months to report, analyze, and report back on what we find. So that test would be the full calendar year of 2015, and we'd report back in spring of 2016 with the results. We could measure from the transportation side the traffic volume, the speed, the number and severity of crashes, the travel time through the corridor, travel times for emergency vehicles in the corridor. What else did I say here? We could observe the use of potentially of people walking and biking, recognizing that we might not see an increase there, and the intersection operations. We could conduct a public opinion survey either during and after or midway through the test or towards the end of the test to see what the public opinion is. And Ed can talk a little bit more about the details of an economic study, which I think gets to the question. It's a potential, but there has not been a decision made, of course, whether or not to perform a test and what elements would be included in it. So, Ed, could you talk a little bit more about the broad strategy of an economic study specific to Willamette Street?
Would you clarify your question? Just repeat it, the one you had.
Should I speak in the microphone?
Sure. Yeah. Yes, please.
My question basically was, since you have looked over all the literature critically, and all I've done is read your report and listen to your presentation, was whether the kind of restriping study with the other changes that Chris just went through were going to make any of a significant addition to the literature that already exists in terms of trying to decide whether there's any economic impact up or down.
Okay, the only part I'd net out of that is whether it would make a contribution to the literature or not. That would be a criterion for someone else, perhaps, but I think we would be most interested in conducting or participating in this effort, or someone else like us, if it would actually add to the information for the decision making, whether it's mulling by the Planning Commission or mulling by the City Council. And there are certain necessary conditions for such a study. I don't know that they're sufficient, but one has to do with capturing seasonality. It's not only time of day of the week, but week of the year and so on, and the influence for other reasons of the university and its effects. David Nelken reacts to this, but actually getting some connection between the traffic and the revenues, so a very important part of this would be getting enough responses, participation by the businesses, by the nature of the activity, secure, confidential, all that kind of stuff, that would allow us to link fluctuations in traffic and the nature of the traffic and the season and so on with the revenues of the businesses. So it'd be that combination that would be coordinated very closely to the transportation specifics, striping, whatever.
And the last piece is the budget that I forgot. So the construction costs to construct the traffic signal at Woodfield Station's driveway and restripe the street is approximately $760,000, plus the cost to monitor the transportation system, the economics, and public opinion. Those elements are an additional. Estimated $160,000, $50,000 for transportation, $50,000 for economics, and $60,000 for public opinion or thereabouts. These are rough numbers. So one might wonder how that compares to the total street improvements. We're talking about $920,000 for a test. The cost to implement alternative one, and these are revised numbers from earlier estimates as we've learned more about the details, that alternative one also includes a permanent traffic signal, $4.6 million plus, and that includes $2.1 million of pavement preservation work. Alternative three, the three lanes with bike lanes, is $4.85 million. And then alternative five is a little bit more. That's the three lanes with wide sidewalks, is $5.6 million. So 4.6, 4.8, and $5.6 million. The incremental cost to do the test relative to those alternatives, most of it is the monitoring. The construction additional work that we would not have otherwise done in alternative one is $54,000, and then alternatives three and five are equal at $13,000 for construction. Adding in $160,000, you get plus or minus $200,000 as the cost of implementing the test.
So that's the net cost?
Yes. And it depends on the scope of the analysis, predominantly.
Okay, I have, or is that your presentation? Because the hands
there.
Are going up.
Yes.
Okay, I have Commissioner Belcher first, then myself, then Commissioner Duncan, Jaworski. Okay.
So I'd like to flip the question. So is there any reason why you couldn't go for the full-blown redevelop the street, see what the impacts are, and if they're too major, then just restripe it back to, let me be more specific. Let's assume you're doing alternative three, the five lane, three car, two bikes. If you constructed that, then did a study after a year and found that it wasn't working, could you not then restripe it back to the three lane option?
It's possible, but there are concerns about how we lay out the paving panels and where the stripes are and times of inclement
are, yeah.
weather and at night. So in the dark when it's raining, what you can see on the street are the joints in the pavement. And currently, the striping lines up with the joints in the pavement. We would, with a street reconfiguration, attempt to replicate that. And then removing the stripes creates this ghost effect that is often more visible than the actual stripe itself. So there's some concern about flipping back. The advantage of a test is that it's not permanent and the total pavement surface would be replaced. And we could also learn from the test that if something was an unintended consequence or there needed to be some adjustment of the lane widths for operation of transit and emergency vehicles, we could fine-tune that in the final implementation. So there is some value to the test. It's not perhaps necessary based on the study and the body of work or experiences of other communities, but there is value in the test.
And I would add, and we'll talk about it later, the mandates that exist at the state, federal, and local level that we put bike lanes on the street. But we'll get to that.
Okay. And I was next, but I'll pass. Commissioner Duncan.
I'd just like to ask a question about the duration of a year-long study. It seems to me that, and again, being one of those seniors that don't have smartphones that I just remember to turn off when he said that, is a year really long enough? It seems to me consumer behavior changes. I did some studies of that years ago. It seems like it takes much longer than a year for somebody to adapt to a change like this and really sort of change their behavior. So I'm curious if there would really be any good results come out of a study sort of a year apart like Chris is talking about.
It's common to have a year duration for tests like this in other communities for some of the reasons that were mentioned, that Ed mentioned, the seasonality effects. The city of Ashland, Oregon, had conducted a Oregon Department of Transportation funded test for a year period. Some communities have not found their answer at the end of that period and have continued their test. But the answer is really as long as it needs to be in order to inform a decision and gather enough information to do that, and what's typical is a year.
Commissioner Jaworski.
Well, I have several. I guess the first one is some clarity. I don't know even how to phrase it because I'm confused here. If you're looking at alternative three and you're doing what you said and it's roughly 920,000, and I believe, Chris, you were saying that some of the improvements that you're making would be made under alternative three anyway, and therefore, I think you used the term, the net effect or cost is $200,000?
Primarily for the testing.
Go ahead.
Basically, the striping is the additional cost because we'll have to restripe the street after we pave it. And the striping for the test is a new cost that we would not have otherwise incurred in the project.
I guess what I'm trying to get at is if you did alternative three, but you're doing the test, I'm just trying to get something really out there. It's only costing $200,000 if a test proved that alternative three is the way to go, and then you finish it. Second part of that question is, if it proves it isn't, then are those same improvements you did improvements that are envisioned in the other alternatives? And then the next question would be, does that then mean that the other alternatives would also then have to have a year-long striping test to see how what their impact is going to be, if it's four versus the same versus whatever? I guess what I'm getting to is, when do the testing stop, and is this setting a precedent that anytime you're doing road improvements now, we want to do an economic impact study and a test?
Well, hopefully it isn't precedent setting. This is a unique project, and it's quite expensive. We spent over $250,000 of state grant funds, plus my staff time and other funds for EcoNorthwest work here. And that's quite an investment to make a decision, an important decision, about the street here. To go back and answer some of the questions along the way here, the permanent improvements necessary for a test are equal generally across all the potential alternatives. We have four lanes now. That's essentially alternative one. And if at the end of the test it was decided to select the four-lane alternative, there's a slight increase in cost due to a signal pole improvement at 29th Avenue, but the permanent signal at Woodfield Station would remain. And so the there's this marginal cost of construction compared to alternative one of $54,000 plus $160,000 to monitor. Alternatives three and five are smaller because it's just the striping of $13,000 that's additional. And then if you wanted to revert back, if you decided, because say alternative three was successful, you would leave that in place until reconstruction in 2018. But if it's not successful, then we would remove the stripes for another $13,000.
Okay, that's where I'm getting into the question of the testing. Like, I don't understand how you'll get the criteria to make that decision. In other words, is someone going to take a look at these businesses, get their revenues per month over a year, aggregate it, and let's say there's $50 million in sales here or there, and then take a look at what you do on the aggregates of the business and say, well, guess what? We did this striping, and instead of an annual sale of $250 million, it was $249. Does that mean the test failed? Or I don't understand what the test is going to prove unless there's a significant sort of decrease that also accounts for the general economy and how that's going to affect what people are spending, whether or not there's a transportation impact change. So I'm really confused as to what this test is going to do and even why it's needed.
So, Prem, we'll get to the economic.
Well, just to make sure, the economic analysis has to purge the effects we're interested in from the larger economic forces. So anything going on the outside, if there's a decline in the economy, we net that out.
Yep, okay.
So that we can focus on. That would not contaminate.
So you're going to look at all these businesses and their aggregates for a historical reference and then take a look at what the test does.
That would be one way to do it. There's a number of ways of getting rid of the forces over which we have no control.
And I guess my criteria question is if I don't know if it has been done elsewhere. If it's been done elsewhere, what is the criteria that determines whether or not it failed or passed?
Well,
that's my question.
Okay.
So the as I stated earlier, the primary purpose is for the community to experience a different number of travel lanes. And what you can do along with that is observe the effects on business and observe the effects on the transportation system and observe the effects on public opinion. none of which are necessarily criteria. They're all choices in the process of decision making, and they're information that we can gather to help inform a decision. And as I present and intend to present that information to the City Council is, here is information that we can gather to help you decide. We're not setting up criteria of pass-fail or grading an exam here, but it's information to help inform you. Did the traffic volumes go up or down? Were they relative to what we projected? That would be interesting information, but in itself doesn't decide should you convert the street from four lanes to three lanes. What are the effects on the economy? They may go up, they may go down, but that in itself doesn't decide whether or not you should do this, because as it was stated earlier, there are demonstrable benefits to safety on the street. And that's one thing that we could measure. Well, did crashes go up or down? And that helps inform the decision-making. Not criteria, but information.
So you're saying that all these various studies that I've looked at in here that have been looked at that said crashes went down, and that's already happened, I'm trying to say, well, why isn't that reference to those studies enough to say you don't need to do your own?
Well, that's a good question. Decision-making in this community is difficult. Not everybody agrees, and so we're helping to provide local information for people to make that decision. There appears to be skepticism about studies elsewhere that aren't Eugene-specific, and more specifically, Willamette Street-specific and the conditions there. That's the benefit. Again, it's not necessary to do a test, but it's helpful.
Yeah.
And I'll just jump in, and I believe the impetus for that study came from council. Is that correct?
They requested
information about that. So they were kind of the driving force.
Yes.
Okay. Commissioner Luftig.
I understand the scope of a potential pilot study is really focused on how vehicle traffic reacts to a three-lane with bicycle lane design. I'm curious, when you did the scoping, you did look at potentially adding a slurry seal so it is more attractive for bicycles to use the roadway. How much did that cost?
Early on, we talked about the potential of putting an asphalt sand slurry over the surface of the street to help create a blank chalkboard, if you will, for street restriping. That treatment doesn't repair the pavement irregularities or the drainage problems on the street, and we saw little value in that for creating benefit for the cost, so we deleted that.
I have myself in the queue, and I guess in the idea of the test as it relates to the economics in the area, it seems to me that, and correct me if I'm wrong, and I guess you're the economic expert, it seems like by doing this and doing that test, you take out the disruption of construction aspect of a street from that equation. And so it seems like it would be a quicker way to get data to evaluate the economic impact without factoring in what construction of a road does to businesses during that construction period. Is that correct?
There would be a built-in 3-month adjustment period, yes.
Okay, but I'm thinking when the time comes to actually completely tear up the street, completely redo it, that disruption from construction also has an economic effect on the businesses of the area.
A short-term one, yes.
But depending on the business, if they're tenuous in their business, could potentially affect them more negatively than just coming in, restriping, and that, because it's a quicker turnaround, I guess, on that would have less impact during that changeover period. Does that make sense?
It does. Regardless if there's a test or not, there will be construction, and there will mm-hmm. be construction impacts. Hopefully they're small, and hopefully we do our best to mitigate or minimize the effects on businesses during the construction of the street that's going to happen in 2018, regardless of how many lanes are striped.
Sure.
So the marginal or incremental effect is what happens during a test in that short hopefully short construction period to construct a signal that will have benefits to
which the signal's
businesses.
There anyway.
No.
The signal will be there regardless. Is that whichever option?
Yes.
Okay. Okay. Commissioner Borofsky, then Commissioner Belcher.
Okay. A couple of things. And Chris, you'll have to forgive me, but I'm always have my budget committee hat on, and so I'm going to kind of delve into a little bit of that. One of the things you mentioned was that if under the restriping scenario, you were going to have to do some curb and gutter stuff on the between, I think, 24th and 24th Alley or whatever, where the turn was not there. Would that be done in both scenarios anyways?
Yeah, yes, in order to connect the bikeway systems
okay.
on Willamette Street to 24th Avenue.
Okay, so yeah, even if they kept it at four lane going forward, that's going to be done anyways.
Yes.
Okay. So then my next question is, of this $200,000, well, or of the $760,000, so the street light, we can use gas tax, state gas tax, local gas tax for those types of improvements?
We'll be preparing an answer for this type of question for the council. We don't have it yet, but the system development charges are likely to be used for a portion of the signal.
Okay.
We could potentially use road funds, which are quite scarce, for the balance of the work.
Okay.
And we could use council's discretionary fund,
right,
potentially for study elements.
Okay. And then the $200,000, the $160,000 for the studies, and the extra $50,000 or whatever for contingencies, that would be general fund money, most probably.
Well, it's the difference between the cost of the test versus the cost of the permanent alternative. So it's potentially a mixture of monies to build the test. It's not saying the test costs $200,000. It says it costs $200,000 more than
right.
one of the alternatives. And again, that can be general fund, council funds. It could be road fund. It could be system development charges.
You could use road funds for an economic study? I thought road funds had to be curb to curb.
So that's where it gets complicated. Is you could use portions, you could use fund different colors of money for different portions of the work.
Okay.
And I wouldn't suggest, well, I won't answer the detail of that question because I don't know the answer.
Okay.
But primarily,
by the time
you're right.
By the time you go to council, you'll hopefully have that more flushed out?
Yes, what the range of funding sources are and
okay.
We think we can fund it.
And for me, I mean, I think that's an important part. I mean, the budget committee has gone through and done a $3 million or $2.5 million reduction in general fund expenditures, and programs were cut. You know, newsletters are not going to be produced anymore. And that, you know, so, well.
There'll be fewer.
And if it passes.
Taking
money from general fund to do a study is taking money from programs that may be needed. So, thank you.
Commissioner Belcher.
Well, I'm thinking about Civic Stadium. There are three options that the school board is considering. One was 4J, the Y. That appears to be taken care of at Roosevelt. In order for the Civic Stadium proposal, the Civic Stadium to remain, that requires $3 million of pledges. Right now, the thermometer says $200,000 have been collected. It seems to be a strong possibility that Fred Meyer will be the one that ends up on that site. Have you thought about either the construction impacts or the economic impacts of having a new business on that street when you thought about when that survey would occur and whether it would be likely to be valuable in that, under that scenario? Are you assuming this will all happen before changes occur at Civic?
Well, we can't control the timeline of development unless we choose to, and they're coordinated but separate activities. I couldn't say when the Civic site might redevelop if it does. Certainly, if that happened in the middle of our test, that would add an element of uncertainty or another variable to consider. Ideally, it would not. I think we'll just cross that bridge when we come to it.
Well, but I think it's something you might want to consider when you head down a particular path.
Right. I suppose one path is to say, tell the development, no, it can't happen until we're done with our test.
I don't think you can legally do that.
Right. So, or say, we're gonna hold, put our test on hold, or we're going to extend the period for our test. But we need to get to the end of the test to make a decision so that we can inform a construction project that is going to need funds beyond the pavement preservation bond measure funds in order to construct. And we need time to refine our design and seek those funds.
Understood. Dr. Dwight Law, do you think you could zero out that impact?
I think the answer is we could take a shot at it. And by impact, you're saying adding Freddie.
Negating the, making the analysis valid given a major construction project that could significantly affect the businesses on the site.
There are industry standards or professional literature coefficients that we could use to illustrate the kinds of effects that might or might not occur with Freddie.
But it certainly would impact the reliability every time you throw in another variable.
Oh, yeah, I mean, mainly it's a, the key variable would be the vehicular traffic and then the timing. Time and place matter. So you add Fred Meyer at the Civic Stadium and you're going to affect patterns. I'm not even addressing the issue of market shares among the new set of businesses.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Commissioner Baker.
Yes. I was wondering, in terms of the, if you did do this restriping study, how long would it actually take to do the construction part? In other words, there's still going to be some impacts on the local businesses. So how long would that take, and would there, is the normal policy is you do that and then you sort of sit for a month before you start your one-year study? In other words, let things stabilize after that.
Well, that's part of the three-month period to adjust. I don't know specifically how long it would take to construct. That there's a lot at play here. We don't have a design, and we need to, you know, we create an estimate, but we need to actually do the design and hire a contractor and have a schedule and their availability, and it's weather-dependent to get the stripes down. But I would hope that it would be short and a matter of weeks, not months.
So it would be more like one month to restripe and get the traffic signal and the
well, that's why I said weeks instead of months.
Yeah.
You know, I don't know how many weeks that would be. You know, it's certainly probably more than one. It's probably less than 12. Much less.
Okay. Any other questions from the commissions? Okay.
I have one other question that's more related to the 2018 work. So the stuff that's budgeted is that does not include dealing with the power poles and everything else that's in the pedestrian right of way?
Correct, and thank you for asking about that. We had a high-level cost estimate from the Eugene Water and Electric Board that estimated that it would be $2.6 million to relocate utilities from the corridor perhaps east to Amazon, and then return and connect them to businesses underground. It doesn't underground utilities in the corridor itself. It moves them out of the corridor. It places them underground there. Is there another question there?
Well, just related to that, how does that compare to the cost you saw over in Coburg Road? I've had a continuing run-ins with the web about underground utilities, so I'm
not familiar with that work or the costs or the estimates that you have had.
Your agency did similar work.
I'm just not familiar with it. I'm sorry.
Okay. It would be useful to know how much that costs, just to know whether this estimate from UWeb is a reasonable estimate or not.
It's the best one we have.
Right. But
this might be a time to mention that long-term in the Division Eugene process, there's the South Willamette concept plan to implement Envision Eugene in the area, and the work of the South Willamette Street Improvement Plan is the transportation element of that plan. In that long-term vision, the street design alternatives are compatible with what's called the street side character, or how the edges, the interface between the public and private realm, redevelop over time. Planning staff are working on code revisions to implement that vision, and one thing that we'll be sharing, and it's very brief mention, is that, but of interest to some people, certainly in the room, is how we manage accesses over time. And so the number and location of driveways will be a consideration in that long-term vision implementation work.
Thank you. Commissioner Jaworski?
Yeah, when you mentioned driveways as a follow-up, did I read that there's like 70 driveways on this corridor?
Yes.
And so you'd see, you'd be reducing those significantly, I would think.
With redevelopment, not proactively.
Okay.
Unless people are willing during construction of the pavement preservation project.
To do it then.
Right.
And Willamette Street is what sort of a street classification?
A minor arterial.
Minor arterial. Okay, thank you.
One last question.
Yeah, related to that, related to the design for the final construction, do you have plans to make certain that you allocate certain resources to see about negotiating with property owners about some reductions or shared driveways? I mean, it seems like a natural thing to do, but if you don't budget for it and plan for it, it wouldn't happen as part of that construction phase.
So what we're taking is the willing seller approach, and people that would be willing to combine or reduce the number of driveways if they have multiple driveways along the street. Our city attorney's office is examining the question whether or not we can require over time how you can compel people to share accesses. So we don't have an answer with that yet, is what I hear from other planning staff. I'm looking at the planning director. But that's my understanding,
is
we're looking at the legality of how you actually do that, and that'll come before you as part of the code changes and ultimately the council for decision.
Right. I was thinking more that you would have some staff dedicated to meeting with all of the property owners along there to see if you could get them to realize that some of this work could be covered by your construction project if they agreed to it at the time. And in other words, not that they have to not only know that they have to come forward, but they're well aware that they can come forward, and there's a standard mechanism where the person that they could contact if they were interested. In other words,
they can contact me, and we'll explore this opportunity.
Yeah, I don't think I think you need to really reach out to the built businesses so that they know that there's a person that they can contact and how they would do that, and that they might be willing to discuss it.
I'm a point of contact as the project manager for
okay,
the project,
all right.
And I can get them to the right people as we work towards
okay,
construction.
Okay, so as long as you're meeting with them and they are well aware of that, that's all.
Okay. Commissioner Jaworski?
Yeah, just to follow up, because I'm a little confused on this negotiation thing. It seems to me that if there is a final go, whatever, and let's say you're going to three-lane divide, and you have this center lane, turning lane thing, and you have 70 driveways, how can you design something with any stacking at all that you can have lefts and rights without running into each other? You're going to have to dictate to me, it seems, that some of those are going to have to be moved or the configuration will never work. And you must have already looked at that to have it as an alternative.
We looked at the potential to where driveways are more concerned. The fewer the driveways, the better, to reduce the number of conflicts on the street. But we can only do so much. Our interest is in improving safety on the street, but it's a negotiation as well. And we'll do what we can. We're not making it a requirement of the project on any of the alternatives, but the opportunity exists with any of the alternatives to improve
okay.
the safety of the street.
Let me ask the question a different way. Under a three-lane configuration, if no one agrees to any negotiations and you have the current existing 70 driveways, can a three-lane work that you can go into the center, make lefts and rights without people bumping into each other, I guess is my question.
It will work.
Okay, thank you.
I mean, it'll work differently if you have fewer numbers of driveways. Yeah. People have to figure it out. And that's the responsibility of a driver, is operating a motor vehicle safely or walking safely or riding a bicycle safely. These things can work, but it takes effort and responsibility by people using the system as well.
When you say people's decisions, so you're not going to, in the center lane, put any little arrows that go like left, left, right, right, nothing like that?
Well, those don't tell people specifically where they can or cannot turn. It indicates that the lane is allowed for making left turns.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you, Chris. Thank you, Dr. Whitelaw. And with that, Commissioner Belcher?
I have a series of policy questions, and I wanted to wait until we were done with the rest of this before we got to that. So just put me in the queue wherever that fits.
Okay. Maybe other items from commission?
No, it's a question.
It's a question related to Chris? Okay. Well, I think we've ended the question portion of this discussion as far as related specifically to that. So I would say go ahead and do that.
So, Chris, is this a major street reconstruction? By definition, you're reconstructing the street, right?
We are preserving the pavement of the street. We have an opportunity to make other improvements.
Well, the reason I ask is because the arterial collector street plan says certain things have to happen when there is street reconstruction. This is the way I read it anyway.
To the extent that they can.
Okay.
You know, and there are constraints and exceptions.
Right. But one of those is that according to the transplant, that you need to do transportation projects for bicycles at the time of street reconstruction. And a priority project in transplant is to put a bike lane on Willamette from 20th to 32nd. So would this reconstruction trigger that?
Triggers an opportunity.
Okay.
To build that improvement. Plans identify facilities on networks. The Eugene's Pedestrian and Bicycle Master Plan, consistent with Transplan, identify bike lanes on Willamette Street and bike boulevards on the parallel streets of Oak and Portland Street. But it doesn't say how to go about doing that. And that's the difficult part, and that gets back to the question of why would we do this test. It has not been a particularly easy decision for this community to make. And we've been asking the question for over 10 years, and here we have a pavement project coming up, we have Envision Eugene implementation coming up, and now's the time to resolve whether or not Willamette Street's going to be different moving into that new future vision. So it's the time to answer the question. I can't tell you if it's required because that's not my discretion.
Okay. The state transportation rule says that arterials, including minor arterials, are supposed to have bike lanes. Is that correct?
Unless there are other facilities that meet the need.
Okay. Transplant says there should be a bike lane on this. The arterial and collector street plan says that minor arterials are supposed to have bike lanes. Again, given your caveat, unless they don't fit. I also believe there's something in ICE-T that also says bike lanes are supposed to be provided on major arterials as well. So there are federal, state, and local mandates to put bike lanes on the street. And I believe it's our responsibility to point that out to the city council.
And that I definitely agree with, and using that word responsible, it would be the responsible thing to do to provide an equitable and accessible and safe transportation system for all people using our streets in Eugene. Exactly how we go about doing that is the question before the decision makers.
Even though these documents specifically say bike lanes.
Right, you still have to make the choice.
Okay. But it seems to me to not make the choice means you either have to modify all of those documents, and I don't know how we're going to modify state and federal documents, or otherwise make a clear and cogent argument why bike lanes won't work on this street. And I think it has to be a compelling argument, not just the preference of some people in the community, which were not the majority of the people who took place in the design process that you did an extensive $250,000 project that showed the majority of the people want option three.
Which informed the, as well as this policy context, informed the consultant projects team's recommendation for three lanes with bike lanes. So there is a recommendation out there, and I must distinguish that that's the consultant project team, not staff at this point, making that very recommendation to our decision makers consistent with the argument that you're making.
Okay. I guess I would move that the Planning Commission submit a statement to the City Council pointing out all the documents that support the idea of putting bike lanes on this street.
There are two pages of them listed in their agenda item summary.
Okay.
Of the related policies.
I think we should remind them too. I hope there's a second.
Is there a second?
Well, I'll second just so we can discuss it.
Okay. So it's been moved and seconded. Is there discussion related to the Planning Commission making that recommendation? Commissioner Borowski?
While I'm not opposed to it, I'm not familiar with all those documents, so I at this point, without seeing them and reading them.
I could read them too if you'd like.
Well, in 12 minutes, you know, that, I mean, that's the, I would have a hard time supporting that motion for that reason, not on the merits of whether or not they apply or not, until I could see them and study them. I couldn't vote one way or another on that.
And Chris, I think you said there were two pages of those, and that is in the agenda for the council that's going to council?
The agenda item summary, once it's submitted to the city manager's office, I'm not sure when they release that publicly, but it's already, and it's the same two pages of policy that was in their June 19th, 2013 agenda item summary. So you can read them there. It's all available through the city recorder's office.
And this is going to council when?
April 16th of 2014.
Further discussion, Commissioner Duncan?
Yeah, I agree with Commissioner Borowski. It's not that I'm necessarily opposed, it's just that I'm not really up on all the documentations, particularly two pages worth of information that Chris is talking about. And I'm going to say that I wasn't prepared to handle any motions today because I didn't see anything in the AIS that would suggest we were going to do that, so I'm not prepared to vote on that.
Commissioner Baker.
Question. I understand we have a work session on, the City Council has a work session on this on April 16th, but when is their public hearing?
May 19th is their public hearing date, and we have not yet scheduled their deliberation and action date. It's likely to be at a work session following a couple weeks.
Okay. Well, I would suggest, since there is ample time, you know, we may not be able to make the Actually, do we? I think we have a meeting that was canceled.
No, it was canceled. Yeah,
but we have a meeting that we could still send them something 3 weeks before the May 19th public hearing, and they're likely to have maybe two work sessions on this anyways, given how things.
At that point, the AIS would have been out. We could have.
Yeah, I would just suggest we put it off till the next meeting because that should be give us ample time to still get it into their hopper early if we want.
With that, I'll withdraw the motion.
Okay.
If you approve.
You'll withdraw the second?
I approve.
Okay. So we'll address that at a later date. And I think I would concur. I think with Commissioners Duncan and Borowski, without having all of that right in front of me, I would be a little unclear.
And I'd like recommending to have it too, because it's pretty clear to me.
Okay. And I saw Carolyn and
just
Commissioner Baker.
Along those lines, to help move the discussion forward, it might be helpful either to send out the studies or even a draft of the language that you would be proposing that the commission would submit.
I'd be happy to. Thank you.
Okay.
And I respect the intent of the motion and the information and setting the policy context for the decision-making. I am not an attorney, and I think it would be beneficial to have the city's attorney's office present to answer some of the questions that you're answering, because that's beyond me to say whether or not we're required to do something or not, and often the answer is it depends.
That's another reason why a draft letter would be good. We could give them some opportunity to review.
Thank you. Glad we have another opportunity.
Okay, sounds good. Commissioner Baker.
Yeah, I just wanted to add one other comment regarding the 2018 project. Just that I have concerns because the pedestrian part was an integral part of the improvement plan, and when I hear estimates that the EWAB budget is 50% higher than the total budget for the project, for undergrounding the power lines, I'm quite concerned. So I just think that that's an area that the various organizations that are involved in it should focus on. I think there's a lot of flexibility in the past with eWeb regarding these, and if that's an integral part of improving the pedestrian experience, then we obviously need to get that budget estimate significantly reduced, since it's such, you know, so large compared to the total budget.
Or cost. Funded.
What?
Or funding.
Well, it seems unreasonable.
Okay. Commissioner Jaworski.
Yeah, I guess the I concur with Commissioner Duncan in that this was an update, but at the same time, I have some real reservations and thoughts. We're supposedly a planning commission. We have a major project going through with design and implementation that affects everything from sidewalks to biking to streets to you name it. And this is going to the City Council, and we're not having any comment as whether or not we think this is a good idea, we support the study, or anything. And I just think we should do that other than just saying, well, I heard the update. I mean, I believe the role of the Planning Commission is more than to just hear updates. If it's an issue that affects something that's in planning, we should be at least stating some sort of a position on it.
Carolyn.
And I would just say that formally, the Planning Commission doesn't have a role in transportation projects. That does not preclude you from, if you agree as a commission that you feel this is an important enough project and has a big enough impact on land use and items that are within the Planning Commission's realm, that you can certainly agree to either as a body or as individuals forward a recommendation.
Could you find me where it says somewhere that we have no role in transportation projects? I find that really difficult to understand.
Sure.
Because transportation is affecting all land use, it's affecting all impacts. I can't understand how someone say we don't have anything to do in transportation planning.
Sure. By the way, I'm not saying you can't. You obviously can,
right,
participate.
I'd like a real opinion on that. I think we have a significant role in that, and if you're saying we can or can't, I mean, I think it's more we should. So, yeah, I'd like to get, you know, if the city attorney has some free time, they can give it. I think we have an opinion. We have a role in that.
And I'm going to jump the queue here for a second, Commissioner Luftig, and I think to tag on to what Commissioner Jaworski is saying, I think what I'm hearing and I agree with is that as a commission, you really can't divorce transportation, especially major transportation projects, from overall planning. And I know we've talked about that with planning along the transportation corridors and different things like that related to Envision Eugene. And I think it's just really difficult to understand and even accept, perhaps, that we deal with planning but not with transportation. And I think, to me, you can't really separate those. And I think even what I was hearing in the presentation and the study is that there are so many variables and so many things are interconnected that it's really difficult to separate those from everything. And so to have this focused look at transportation and this focused look at planning. And I know I've always struggled a little bit even with the way we've done the South Willamette Plan, where we've looked at the planning and then it went right up to the curb and then it was the transportation issue. And I understand how our system works. I won't say that I like it, but I think to have those things separated is difficult at best. And that's what I struggle with too. So I have Commissioner Luftig and then Commissioner Belcher. Go ahead.
I was just going to point out that we have in the past worked jointly as a Sustainability Commission and the Planning Commission for CLUTAC, Coordinated Land Use and Transportation Action Committee.
Believe
Advisory
so.
Committee. I'm not quite sure.
Yeah.
On the end.
Advisory Committee.
And that we did focus on a transportation project with our joint effort, the West Eugene MX extension, performing the triple bottom line analysis.
That's true. Good point. Commissioner Belcher.
I was going to say what Commissioner Luftig said, and I would also add, by channeling Commissioner Laddick, that once was our role to provide feedback on the CIP as well, and that has gone by the wayside. Maybe it's time for it to come back.
Oh, we have had an update on that, and there will be a role of the Planning Commission, but that planning is not starting until this fall.
Okay.
Okay.
But we have not lost sight of that.
Okay.
Thank you.
Good. All right. Oh, Commissioner Borofsky, I'm sorry.
I guess for me, the way that I see us weighing in as a Planning Commission, or part of the way, would be how this interacts with the whole South Willamette concept plan. You know, the thing that we've looked at, or a lot of you have looked at more so than I have, and weigh in on that. You know, that's where we have a little bit more knowledge than perhaps the council has at this point, because it hasn't really gone that next step as far as we have here, and bring the transportation part of it, saying this is a key important part, and it will dovetail into land use this way. You know, if we want this corridor to develop the way that we see it developing in the Invention Eugene and in the South Willamette plan, transportation corridors are a part of it. And I see that as being, you know, how transportation and the Planning Committee can move that to the council as an advise and consent type of a piece.
Mr. Belcher?
I would also add that we both were intimately involved with the creation of the arterial and collector street plan, and we also approved or made our recommendations for Transplan. So we are not divorced from transportation per se.
All right. Carolyn?
We do have an update on the Envision Eugene South Willamette Area Planning Project coming up on May 5th. I'm wondering if the commission would want to tack this conversation onto that. It is ahead of the May 14th public hearing, but
seems like a logical thing.
It seems like a logical thing, sure.
Mm-hmm.
Commissioner Duncan?
I guess as part of this, since we always have talked about the marriage of transportation and land use as an important issue in our community, I would like to get some input from the folks working on the South Willamette plan to sort of give us some input on what they think about three lanes, four lanes, and how that could affect the overall redevelopment and of that whole area, and if they think there's an effect on it.
We can talk about that.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, with that, I'd like to thank the Sustainability Commissioners for joining us, and you don't need to leave the table, but we'll move on to agenda item 3, other items from staff.
Hopefully you all received the new agenda today. It does show that next week's Planning Commission meeting has been canceled, and that's because the hearing was left open, or the record was left open in the retreat appeal. So your next meeting will be April 21st.
And that's when we'll begin deliberations on the retreat. Is that correct?
Correct.
Okay.
And the 28th is now not the South Willamette. That's I moved to the 5th?
Correct. And so the deliberations on the retreat will continue on April 28th.
And so is that all encompassed in that revised revised schedule that went out this morning?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. It's all in there.
Okay.
Also wanted to let you know.
How to clear a room, don't we?
Yeah. April 21st will be a public hearing before the City Council on the Employment and Industrial Code amendments that you all reviewed and made your recommendations on.
Are they expecting to take action at that time?
No, that's just a public hearing. Our deliberations are scheduled for May 14th on that same item. Also on May 14th will be the single-family code amendments. So remember, the council took action on the interim protection measures, but not on the rest of the package that included secondary dwelling units and alley access lots and accessory units. So that's scheduled for May 14th.
Okay.
So that, I think, is my update.
And there were, I guess I should look at that, but there was something on deer fencing and monitoring. Is that just postponed?
Those are on the agenda still. Let's see. Deer fencing public hearing is May 6th. I believe that hasn't changed. and we're...
Is that a Planning Commission public hearing or a City Council?
This is Planning Commission. So we're back to Planning Commission. And potential action on that hearing night, because it might be fairly simple. So we'll see if we can do that. Monitoring is currently scheduled for June 2nd. Envisioning June monitoring. But it's all on the up-to-date schedule.
So is the deer fencing, is that the Elizabeth Nielsen Z14?
That's the second item that is also on the same night.
Okay.
And that refers to the Willamette Stationers downtown, a metro plan amendment.
So the deer fencing we may be able to make a decision that night, the other likely not.
Probably we'll need a little bit more process for the okay. metro plan.
Yeah.
And we don't discuss the deer fencing before the public hearing then?
We did have a work session on it.
We used to have a work session on it before.
You know, I think that this is such a minor tweak that we probably don't need a full work session on it, but the idea is we would get the information out to you ahead of time, and then we will have the hearing. If there are questions about it, we also have action scheduled for May 12th on it, so we could do full-on deliberations and questions at that time. But just trying to be efficient, didn't think it warranted a full-on work session prior to the public hearing.
Okay. And we did talk about it before, I do believe.
It's very possible. I think this is one that was initiated by City Council. I think Councilor Taylor brought it up.
South Hills.
Yeah, that you know, our current fence regulations do not allow for those that are tall enough to keep deer out of people's vegetable gardens, and people do more and more of that in their front yards now, and so it's looking at that.
Okay. All right.
Question: what was the date of the council public hearing on employment lands?
April 21st.
Okay.
Could you have the AIS for that sent out to us? Is that possible?
Yes. You have requested that in the past. I'd be happy to do that.
You mean the South Willamette?
No, there's a public hearing on
the employment and industrial.
The employment industrial. Yeah. And so that if we wanted to, we could see the AIS, and if we wanted to testify, we would know what they've seen.
What I'll do is I'll send out a link to the council agenda site that will have it right there.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Anything else from staff, Carolyn?
No, I guess I would just say, in my earlier comments, I didn't mean to say there's no connection between land use and transportation. I hope you know that.
Yes.
What I was trying to communicate was that this body does not regularly have a formal role in street improvement projects. There certainly have been times when the Planning Commission has had a formal role, like TransPlan, and you probably will again, I'm guessing, when we update that on the heels of Envision Eugene. And you're always welcome to opt in and provide your recommendation. And I think that because of the significance of this project, because we do have a parallel land use plan moving forward, I think it makes sense. And so if it's something you want to do, I'd encourage you to go ahead and provide those formal comments or provide a recommendation to council. So it's wasn't trying to say there's no connection there, but just trying to clarify kind of what the formal rules traditionally are and aren't.
And I know I didn't take it that way.
Okay.
But, I didn't take it that way either.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
No, but I'm just saying, like, when you know, I think the planning, I can't speak for the Planning Commission. I know I would have an interest if there's major, let's say, street configurations like on West 11th, which we dealt with, and all kinds of land use issues.
Sure.
You know, when they're doing and looking at the Randy Pappy improvements there, what's that going to do on 3-4 impacted neighborhoods? You know, those kinds of things I think we should look at. I mean, you know, if one wants to fill a pothole, I'm not interested.
And I
Unless
think
it's
from
on your street.
and I think from my perspective, not to beat a dead horse on that, it's
for instance, on South Willamette with 70 driveways, and how, you know, I know we are a democracy, so we can't just start closing off driveways, but, well, generally, but kind of the, and it's a frustration, I think, with our system and how, you know, I mean, democracy is not efficient, and I've said that many times. It's really not an efficient way to run things, but it's should be more fair. And with 70 driveways and doing a major street improvement and a whole plan, to take the opportunity to try and consolidate that, I think, was maybe what Commissioner Baker's point was.
Sure.
You know, and I'm all for that. It just gets frustrating sometimes when you really can't say, okay, we're going to close off this driveway because it's going to be safer for the street or whatever, and those sorts of things. And I think that's you're probably just hearing some of our frustrations with mm-hmm. our whole system more than just than that. So, yeah, items from commission.
I guess I would just tag on that. When we have specific policies that we've developed and we ignore them due to political expediency, that's when I get angry.
Understood. Commissioner Borowski.
Just from me, the subcommittee that I represent as a commissioner, the CDBG subcommittee is having a public hearing tomorrow night to basically go over what the recommendations are and move those forward. So.
Okay.
I doubt there'll be very many people there, but that's what I'll be doing tomorrow evening.
Okay. Other items from commission? Commissioner Baker.
I can't recall. I think I may have given you an update on the Historic Review Board.
I think you did.
And then
the well hall.
Pardon?
The well hall area.
Right. And since then, we met with Public Works and got things squared away. So actually, okay. that looks positive. And then
with reinstalling some of the street lights out there,
right? There was some reluctance from Public Works, and another area. There was interest in the Historic Review Board to redo inventories in the older parts of town that haven't been, well, the inventory historic review mm-hmm. inventories haven't been done in a long period of time, and also what we consider historic, the age of buildings, you know, keeps.
Just because it's old doesn't necessarily make it historic.
Right, and also, but now you consider buildings that, you know, instead of before 1900, now you consider buildings before 1940 or something. You know, the date changes as it's 25 years since we last did this. So they are interested in doing that, and they did work with a class at the University of Oregon that did a newer inventory of parts of Western University in the neighborhood. And I think they plan on trying to find some ways of doing that in the other neighborhoods directly around the university. And they chose those areas because they figured that they're threatened. And so if there's any opportunity to identify historic resources and maybe make some mechanisms available to that they might prefer preserved. They're also in the process of revising some of the language related to historic preservation in our code to sort of modernize it and bring it up, eliminate some issues with it. So that's an ongoing thing that's that will be considered at the next meeting.
Okay, thank you. Okay, with that, we're adjourned.